Indian freedom struggle was dominated by a group of heterogeneous women and men. And why not? They were fighting for a country so heterogeneous, so plural in culture. One of those men of whom we celebrate the 195th birth anniversary is Dadabhai Navroji, also known as the Grand Old Man of India. Navroji's name is also associated with the Jain theory that he propounded. He was born in 1825 at Navrasi in the Eastwell Bombay Presidency, which is presently in Gujarat. He was a Parsi by religion and his family was Gujarati speaking. He was an Athonan or an ordained priest, and as part of this, in 1851, he started the Rehnuma Masjidasan Sabha to restore the purity of the Zoroastrian religion and started an Anglo-Gujarati fortnightly called as the Rast Guftar or the Truth Teller. He travelled to the UK in 1855 to partner with a cotton company and did so. But after a few years, he resigned and started his own company, Dadabhai Navroji & Co. Later, he was appointed as a professor of Gujarati at the University College London. Thus, his career in education, administration and reform began. In 1861 and 1867, he started the London Indian Society and the East Indian Association respectively in the UK. And the motive of these organizations were to discuss Indian social, political and literary subjects. Also to counter the British theory that the Europeans were superior to Asians racially. On his return to India in 1874, he was appointed Diwan or the minister in the court of Maharaja of Baroda, Sayaji Rao Gaikwad III, and became a member of the Bombay Legislative Council in 1885. He became a part of the Indian National Association, an organization started by Sundarnath Banerjee and another moderate freedom fighter. These two organizations led to the formation of the Indian National Congress in 1885, and Dadabhai Navroji presided over the second annual session of Congress in 1886 at Kolkata. He later moved back to Britain to continue his struggle for the Indian independence, and in 1892 he became the first Indian to be elected as a Member of Parliament to the British Parliament for Liberal Party from Finsbury Central. When elected, he refused to take an oath from the Bible as he was a Parsi and took oath from Parsi religious book Kode Avesta. He continued his struggle and reached a notable position. In 1901, he propounded his theory of drain of wealth in his book Poverty and Un-British Rule in India. In this theory, he proved that Britain was draining money out of India and mentioned six factors that proved the same, like free trade by the British, empire building activities and so on. He estimated a loss of 200 to 300 million pounds from India to Britain, a wealth that wouldn't be returned. In 1906, he was elected as the president of the Indian National Congress. Navroji always remained a moderate even when the party was split into moderates and extremists. He was a supportive mentor to the likes of Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Gopal Krishna Gokhale and Mahatma Gandhi, among others. His mentees always held him in high regard. While Mahatma Gandhi said that the Indians looked up to Navroji like children do their father, Bal Gangadhar Tilak said that if 28 crore Indians were entitled to send only one member to the British Parliament, no doubt that we would elect Dadabhai Navroji anonymously to grace the post. Navroji was a nationalist, but not the kind of nationalist that we see today. He believed in an idea of nationalism, which meant having an Indian identity overrode religion, caste, class or ethnic differences. In 1893, he told the Congress that whether he was a Hindu, a Mohammedan, a Parsi, a Christian, or any other creed, above all, he was an Indian. He firmly believed that India as a country and a nationality was Indian. Throughout his long political career, he strived to be inclusive and ensured minority participation. His upbringing in Bombay led him to become concerned about the plight of the minorities. He was the definition of secularism as he listened to the Marathi assessments of colonial exploitation, discussed economics with a Konkani Muslim, and ran a newspaper with a Kapol Baniya. Even in his political ventures, people from all across India participated without having any caste, creed or religious barriers. Navroji was one of the few people who realized the fundamentalism of India lies in the fact that India works better when worked together. The Britishers expressed some doubts when he was elected as the Indian representative to the British Parliament. They wondered how a Parsi can be representative to a country which is compressed of majority Hindus and a considerable size of Muslim community. The doubts were destroyed by the kind of welcome Navroji received when he returned to India in 1893 to head the annual Congress session held in Lahore. At Bombay, he was welcomed by almost half the city's population and was honored by Hindu priests and Muslim qazis alike. During his journey from Bombay to Lahore, he made several stops in between. He was received by mill workers at Ahmedabad. In Chandni Chowk, Hindus and Muslims placed him at the head of a glorious procession. The Sikhs gave him holy water from the Amrit Sarovar and Golden Temple and tied golden and pink scarvaces to his Parsi headgear. In Lahore too, Navroji visited temples and mosques and gurudwaras. And by the end of this, Navroji had realized that above everything else, these people were Indians and that was our ultimate identity. Navroji believed in the tradition of tolerance, but turned a blind eye to few social issues, untouchability being one of them. He studied poverty closely, but untouchability did not seem to catch his attention. He was an endorser of everything Swadeshi, but thought twice before supporting boycotts and strikes as they seemed unconstitutional. The manners and customs of Parsi, the European and the Asiatic race, the wants and means of India, poverty of India were some of the famous books written by him. The glimpse we get into Dadabhai's personal life are very few. We know he was married to Gulbai at the age of 11. His granddaughters Pareen and Khushruben carried his legacy forward as both of them were involved in the freedom struggle. Navroji breathed his last in Bombay on 13 June 1917. He was 91 years old. As a tribute to his glorious life, a heritage road in Mumbai is named after him as the Dadabhai Navroji Road. There is also a road with the same name in Pakistan too. A residential colony for central government officers in South Delhi is named after him as the Navroji Nagar, and there is a street in Finsbury area of London called Navroji Street. As we're reaching the end of the video, there are a few questions which remain unanswered. What would Navroji think of the idea of nationalism we are practicing today? What would he say about the crisis faced by the immigrants during the present lockdown? Would he approve of the chauvinistic conservative attitude we observe today? More than all of this, if he were to be alive today, would the current population of India accept him for the secular nationalist he was or not? As I leave you to ponder over these questions, I conclude once again remembering Navroji for the exemplary human being he was on his birthday.